Dear friends, I'm Dr. K. Kannan, Professor of Mechanical Engineering, Anjaliyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you again through the video lecture series on the subject heat and mass transfer. This is lecture number 303, the module 3, condensation heat transfer. The topic for today's discussion is condensation heat transfer, and we will discuss the filmwise and dropwise condensation, and we will see the correlations available for calculating heat transfer coefficient in filmwise condensation process. And in the previous lecture, we discussed the boiling heat transfer, and the boiling heat transfer and the condensation heat transfer, they are very distinct and a special type of heat transfer process where the phase change takes place. So in the boiling heat transfer, the liquid is converted into vapor. In the condensation heat transfer, the vapor is converted into liquid. And here, at the end of this lecture, the student will be able to explain what is filmwise condensation and what is dropwise condensation. And they will be able to compare the filmwise and the dropwise condensation, and they explain the effect of non-condensable gases in the condensation process. Condensation is converting the vapor into liquid. So in the lower semester, we studied about the boiler plant. And in the boiler plant, there is one device called a condenser, where the low pressure steam from the turbine enters, and the steam is cooled and converted into condensate or water vapor. So when the vapor is cooled below its saturation temperature, water vapor is cooled, or any vapor is cooled below its saturation temperature, at the particular pressure, the vapor being converted into liquid. So when the surface temperature is lower than the saturation temperature of the vapor, the condensation will occur. There are two types of condensation. One is filmwise condensation, another one is dropwise condensation. So these are the two types. So we take a simple plate, vertical plate, with the plate surface is maintained at 80 degrees Celsius, and we assume the steam at atmospheric pressure, water vapor steam at the atmospheric pressure, is falling onto the surface. So at atmospheric pressure, the saturation temperature is 100 degrees Celsius. Now the surface temperature is 80 degrees Celsius. So the steam loses its heat energy. The amount of heat energy removed is called as latent heat of evaporation or latent heat of condensation. So when the heat is removed, the vapor is converted into liquid, and the liquids are deposited or available on the surface of the plate, and the liquid particles will flow downward. So the liquid particles are formed on the surface of the tube, and they are flowing downward. So if the liquid particle is in the form of a film, so always there is a layer of water available on the surface of the plate, then it is called as liquid film, and this is called as film-based condensation. And sometimes, when you have some oil particle on the surface, or the surface is highly polished, then there is a possibility of droplets. The liquid, instead of film, you may find droplets of water on the surface of the plate. And among the two condensation process, the dropwise condensation will have better heat transfer rate, better condensation rate, because for incoming vapor, so the free surface available here, more free surface available here. So the incoming vapor will directly meet the surface and loses its heat energy and converted into liquid. Whereas here in the filmwise condensation, you have a layer of liquid. So we have a layer of liquid always. So the heat is transferred between the vapor and the surface through the layer, liquid layer. So the liquid layer offers some resistance for the heat transfer. So the amount of heat transfer here is less, amount of condensate is also less. But it is very difficult to maintain the dropwise condensation. all the heat exchanger, all the condenser, they are working only on the film-wise condensation method. So all the heat exchanger, all the condenser, they are designed only for the film-wise condensation method. And this is what the film-wise condensation on a vertical plate. So you look at here, so the gray color area is the vapor at temperature, saturation temperature, and you have the plate, cold plate at temperature lower than the saturation temperature of the vapor. Now the heat is, actually we assume number of layers of vapor and the heat is lost by the vapor. So it is forming a liquid here on the surface and liquid layer is falling downward. So if you look at here, this is the boundary layer, this is the thickness of the boundary layer and thickness of the film also, thickness of the film. So this is what called as water film. The thickness is called as boundary layer thickness or film thickness. This is also called as film thickness. Outside the film or outside the boundary layer, it is only vapor. So inside, when it is falling into the boundary layer, it is losing its heat energy and converted into vapor. And converted into liquid. And the liquid, they are moving downward. So if you look at the velocity profile, so they are moving downward and the velocity is increasing, and here it is maximum velocity, then again the velocity is decreasing. And similarly, when you look at the temperature here is lower, so here vapor temperature is higher, the vapor temperature is keep on decreasing, and here you have somewhere the saturation temperature. So when the saturation temperature, when the vapor temperature reduces to saturation temperature, immediately it is converted into liquid and the droplets are, liquid droplets are moving downward. So this is what the film-wise condensation on a vertical plate. And we have the, we are not going to discuss any theoretical aspects of the condensation heat transfer. So we are going to take only the correlations available in the heat and mass transfer data book for calculating the boundary layer thickness or the heat transfer coefficient. So the main parameter is heat transfer coefficient. Once you know the heat transfer coefficient, then you can calculate the rate of heat transfer. For vertical surface, let it be a plate or tube, a vertical plate or vertical surface, the boundary layer thickness is delta x equal to 4 mu L k x into Tb minus Ts divided by g into hfg star into rho square to the power 0.25. And the heat transfer coefficient equal to h equal to 0.943 k to the power 3 rho square g hfg star divided by mu L 4 L mu L into Tb minus Ts. So these are all the different parameters. So K is the thermal conductivity of the liquid, X or L. So here I have the X value for any given X or any given length. We can calculate the boundary layer thickness or and the heat transfer coefficient. X or L, it is distance along the surface. Tb is the vapor temperature at the given pressure, and Ts is the surface temperature. Rho is the density of the liquid. Mu L is the dynamic viscosity of the liquid, and G is the acceleration due to gravity, which is constant 9.81, and HFG star is the modified latent heat of evaporation. So this HFG is from the steam table for the vapor temperature plus 0.68 into CPL into Tv minus Ts. So why the value is modified? So this is additional parameter on the HFG. Normally what we said, when the heat is removed equivalent to latent heat of vaporization, the vapor will be converted into liquid. But due to the dynamics of the vapor, so we have to extract some more amount of heat energy. So the additional amount of heat energy to be removed is 0.68 times of CPL into Tv minus Ts. That means the vapor is to be cooled below the saturation temperature, that is what the idea. Then n is the number of horizontal rows of the tube, in when you have more number of plates or the tubes. Then horizontal tubes, so h equal to 0.728 into k to the power 3 rho square g hfg star divided by mu L d. Now instead of L, it is replaced by d, Tv minus Ts to the power 0.25. And when you have n numbers of tubes, so tube bundle, a real condenser is a horizontal tube bundle. So h equal to 0.728 into k to the power 3 rho square into g into hfg star divided by mu L n into d into Tv minus Ts whole to the power 0.25. So there are only three different types of problem, either it may be vertical plate or vertical tube. Then we have horizontal tube and horizontal tanks of tubes. So you calculate the heat transfer coefficient. Once you have the heat transfer coefficient, we can calculate the rate of heat transfer. So rate of heat transfer equal to Q equal to HA into TV minus TS. So H is the heat transfer coefficient from the correlation. A is the area for heat transfer. So in the case of cylinder, it is pi d into L. In the case of a plate, it is length into width. So TV is the vapor temperature and TS is the surface temperature. Then rate of the condensate flow. So M equal to Q by HFG. So HFG star is the lateral heat of evaporation. So Q is the amount of heat transfer in the condenser. So M equal to Q by HFG star equal to HA into TV minus TS divided by HFG star. And then we discuss the dropwise condensation. So this is what the dropwise condensation. Vapor droplets are found on the condensing surface, which is called as dropwise condensation. So what is the advantage of the dropwise condensation? More condensing area is exposed to the incoming vapor. So that is why the heat transfer coefficient in the case of dropwise condensation is 5 to 10 times greater than the filmwise condensation. So H value for dropwise condensation is more. But there is no, we do not have any, we are not going to discuss the correlations or equations for dropwise condensation calculation. So what we do at undergraduate level, it is only filmwise condensation. It is difficult to maintain the dropwise condensation. Actually, filmwise condensation is very possible. It is what it is naturally occurring, but dropwise condensation is not possible to maintain. So when you apply some chemicals on the surface, oleic acid, salicylic acid, and benzyl mercaptan, so we can maintain the dropwise condensation. Or surface coating with gold, silver, platinum, it is also promote the dropwise condensation. So there are some drawbacks. So surface coating like gold, silver, platinum is very costly, so it is not affordable. Whereas when you apply some chemicals on the surface, for initial few hours, you may find the dropwise condensation. After continuous flow of the vapor and the liquid, so the chemicals will be washed away. Then again, the filmwise condensation will provide. So normally, we design the condenser only for filmwise condensation process. And the next topic, the presence of non-condensable gas in the condensation process. So we look at the condenser. This is what the condenser. So we have horizontal tube and the steam enters at the top from the turbine and flows on the cell side. And the condensate is here flowing here downward and it is removed by the condensate extraction pump. And you have the cooling water is entering here, flow through the tube. And you take a turn and flow on the top tubes and leaving here. And in between you have, this is the opening for air pump. So why air pump? Why we connect the condenser to air pump? The condenser is operating at lower pressure, lower than the atmospheric pressure. So we maintain the condenser pressure lower than the atmospheric pressure to extract more work from the steam. So in a steam power plant, so the condenser pressure is designed for lower value, lower than the atmospheric pressure, or the condenser is operating at the vacuum pressure so that the power plant work output from the turbine will be very high. That is the idea. Now, what is the effect of the low pressure or vacuum pressure inside the condenser? And we have the tube plate, we have mechanical joints everywhere in the condenser. So inside the condenser, the pressure is very low. And outside we have the atmospheric pressure. So there is a possibility of leakage of air into the condenser. So when the air leak into the condenser, so that is to be removed to maintain the pressure as constant, lower than the atmospheric pressure. That is why we have the air pump. So the periodically, the using the pump, the air from the condenser is removed. Now we discuss what is the effect of the non-condensable gas. So the air is one non-condensable gas. What is the effect of the presence of non-condensable gas in the condensation process? Now look at here, we have a blanket of non-condensable gas. What is the effect? When the incoming vapor, it has to flow through the non-condensable gases and then it has to meet the cold surface. So what is the effect? So it has to travel, penetrate, the vapor has to penetrate through the non-condensable gas, then it will meet the cold surface for condensation. So the amount of heat transfer is reduced because of the restriction offered by the non-condensable gas. So effective condensation may not take place. So that is why we have to remove the air from the condenser, and we have to maintain a minimum level of, so almost minimum level of non-condensable gas. So presence of the non-condensable gas inside the condenser, the amount of condensate flows or amount of heat transfer in the condensation process decreases, and the heat transfer coefficient is also decreasing. So we stop here. In the next lecture, we take few problems on the condensation heat transfer. And these are all the books I referred for preparing the notes. So you can also refer to it for better idea on the topic. And I have published a book on the subject. You can collect it, and you can find more information and more problems on the condensation heat transfer. So if you have any queries, you can write to my mail ID. So I will sincerely answer. Until then, it is thank you. So you can also comment after seeing the video. You can also comment on the video. You can pass on your comment, and the comments will be useful for preparing or presenting the subject in a better way. Thank you.